morning, everyone. How are you doing today? Really, it's a privilege and an honor for me to introduce the next speaker. He has been a member of the Teamsters since 1976, some 38 years. He started his life in the union, working in the oil fields for Penn's Oil Company. And he rose through the ranks through his local union, Local 175 in West Virginia. He was a shop steward, a bargaining committee member. Then he became a business agent for Local 175. He moved up to the executive board as a vice president and then became its president many years ago. He has served and continues to do so as the director of the Teamsters Small Package Division. You know that as UPS. He has served and been elected as a vice president at large of our international union. During bargaining with UPS, he has successfully negotiated two amazing contracts over the last decade or so. UPS and the Teamsters contract is the largest single collective bargaining agreement in the United States. It covers under that one contract a quarter of a million members. It is with pleasure that I get the opportunity to introduce to you my friend, our General Secretary Treasurer of the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, Ken Hall.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, one thing that I always say is if you want to learn what people do, you don't ask people in Washington, D.C., you go out where the people are. And so I appreciate last night meeting so many of you, and you educated me on what your issues are. It was great for me. I mean, I've spent my entire career spending time out around the country, talking with our members. And I have to tell you that on some subjects I know a lot more than I wanted to. But in terms of what you folks told me last night, it was very, very educational, and I thank you for that. So first of all, are you having a great time in Vegas? And I'm sure you're winning a lot of money. Because they build all these new casinos on winners' money, you know that. The first thing I want to do is thank Dennis Spears and his executive board for inviting me here. I've had the opportunity to work with Dennis for the last few years, and I got to tell you, I'm quite impressed with the way he runs the business. I see a lot of similarities between Dennis and me. We both care deeply about the union, but we both care deeply about being who we are. And being able to, you know, I'm much happier if I can hang out with our members than I am with some rich muckety-muck somewhere at some fancy place. So I think Dennis feels the same way, and I'm quite impressed with that. So thank you very much for inviting me here today. You know, the Rail Conference is 10 years old now within the Teamsters. And I think that it's safe to say that both the BMWED as well as the BLET, are stronger being part of the Teamsters. With almost 75,000 members, the Rail Conference is now the seventh largest division within the Teamsters. And at the federal and state level, your legislative directors tell me that being a Teamster has opened a lot of doors that were hard to get into before you became Teamsters, because now when you're reaching out with the strength of 1.4 million members, and I think that's important. You know, before I talk about some of your issues, I guess as your Secretary Treasurer, I should talk about our finances, because that's part of my responsibility as the General Secretary Treasurer to keep an eye on the money and also to report back to you as to where we stand. So I'm proud to report to you. Now, some of you weren't around. You've been around for 10 years. I've been around a long time in this union. You know, John was giving you all those, you know, I started back in, you know, whatever, 1970. I just want you to know one thing, though. It makes it sound like I'm really old. I was 10 years old when I started in the Teamsters. So, you know, I can remember the day when we didn't have a strike fund. And it was horrible going to your members who are going on the street, going on strike, and they say, do I get strike benefits? And yet the answer has to be, no, we don't have a strike fund. It was broke. So I'm incredibly proud to report that as of today, our strike and defense fund currently stands at more than $124 million. In fact, we have almost $19 million more in that fund than we did only 1 year ago. And if you add the general fund and a strike and defense fund, our union has more than $193 million. And that's actually increased by more than $26 million from this time last year. So what does that mean? So you got a lot of money, we're not a bank. What does that really mean? That really means that we've got the money, we've got the resources to take on the fights that's necessary to protect our contracts, including your contract, to protect our standards, and to organize more members. Because I don't have to tell you that there's a lot of forces out there that want to silence us. You got all the politicians, or not all the politicians, but there are a lot of anti-union politicians, a lot of corporate bullies who just hate unions. And you got all these Wall Street fat cats who frankly don't give a shit about anybody except themselves. All they want to do is make more and more and more money. So all of them want to silence us by passing more right-to-work laws, taking away rights that we have fought for generations, and passing legislation that hurts our members and squeezes our members to a breaking point so that they don't have the strength to speak out. And you know what? They're not going to win this battle. You know, we may have people who has a lot of money. We have the Koch brothers and others who are spending gazillions of dollars trying to silence us. But the one thing that we have that they don't is we have heart and we have boots on the ground. And at the end of the day, if we get out and we go to work, the one thing that I can say about the BLET and the Teamsters is, if you screw around with us, we're going to kick the shit out of you. Now let's talk about one of those issues that's so important to you folks, high-speed rail. You know, the Teamsters Rail Conference has really worked tirelessly to advocate on behalf of funding for Amtrak and for the planned high-speed rail initiative. And the first leg of that's planned for California, I believe. And, you know, there's always people in Congress who won't support us. But we're working to make sure that those who do support working families understand that high-speed rail projects will employ thousands of workers and bring economic growth to towns and cities everywhere that it connects. And I know that something that's near and dear to you is your contract negotiations. The first round of national handling negotiations after you became Teamsters produced one of your best contracts in 30 years, and that's a great thing. And next year, you'll be at the table again, and your fellow Teamsters, all of us, 1.4 million members, are going to be with you 100% when you go to that table. Whatever Dennis Pierce says he needs, he's going to get from the IBT, whether that's research, whether that's contract negotiations assistance, whatever he needs, that's what he's going to get from the IBT. And let's talk about another subject that's been there's been a lot of discussion about lately, and that's the two-man crews. Now, first of all, I'm aware that some other union went in and cut some deal to eliminate the second person. One, that's short-sighted. Two, well, you know, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this, but it sounds to me like somebody's in a company's pocket. The one thing I'm certain of is that the person in their pocket is not the BLET. You know, one of the greatest threats to rail safety has been the carrier's desire to eliminate half of the crew on an engine. You know the importance of having a two-man crew on the rails, and I got to tell you, we absolutely, with everything we have at the IBT, support you in your fight in this critical safety requirement. Our legislative staff is keeping an eye on the progress of HR 304, and we'll work with you to keep it on track. You know, for these rail corporations to try and weasel out of a safety requirement is just simply irresponsible, both to our members as well as the general public. So you can count on the fact, I don't give a shit what the UTU did. We're going to fight to keep two people on there. Your fight is our fight. And some days I wonder, who are they representing, their members or the company? So we're gonna stay in this fight with you. We're gonna do whatever it takes to make sure that we keep two people on there. Hey, it's important, right? These are important issues. I mean, this seems like a no-brainer to me. And, you know, let's talk about the High Alert publication. Ever since you merged with us in 2004, we've all been working toward increasing safety on the rails. In 2005, the Rail Conference issued a survey to all rail members, which resulted in the publication of the High Alert Report. The results in that report pushed Congress to pass the first rail safety bill in years. And you know how that happened? There's no rocket science here. That happened because of your efforts in exposing the safety and security concerns that you deal with every day. So congratulations on getting that done, and give yourselves a big hand. Now let's talk about our retirements. Retirements are an incredibly important thing. I mean, it's really the difference between people who work their entire lives and now they're ready to retire. It's the difference between being able to retire with some dignity versus having to, you know, take the scraps off the table. So it's incredibly important to all of us. You know, I understand my neighbor's a BLET member, so he spent a lot of time explaining to me how your retirement works in terms of, you know, the fact that you get a different retirement than maybe I do with Social Security. But regardless of all that, a secure retirement is a moral imperative for all hardworking Americans. And you know what? I don't care what their politics is. Elected officials should be obligated to protect America's safety. Retirement safety net. That's something that there should not be a debate about. You know, during the recession, workers, you know, they've done their part. They've helped their employers. They've taken, you know, during the difficult economic times, they've taken cuts to their salaries and benefits. You know, in return, the least the United States can do is to ensure that Social Security benefits are there for them. Lawmakers rightfully determined that making cuts to Social Security is just a bad idea. But they should follow the lead of one of our more progressive senators, Elizabeth Warren, and not only talk about saving Social Security, but they should be calling for the program to expand, because working people, people who spend their entire lives working for a company, deserve a decent retirement. And so we're at a time when big business is only paying a tenth of the amount of taxes that they did in the 1950s. So we must ensure that our pensions that our workers have earned are going to be there for them when they retire. Workers shouldn't be. You know, it's become this. I listen to these. I mean, I'm just amazed sometimes. I listen to some of these fat cats that's making a fortune doing nothing. And I listen to them say, oh my God, these pensions, these unions, they're destroying the country. Well, why should people have pensions? Really? So they've got $10 million bailouts and $10 million golden parachutes. And they think the fact that union workers have a pension is a bad idea. You know what? They're either out of touch or they just don't give a damn about people. And I think it might be the latter. You know, our workers, we shouldn't be criticized for receiving pensions. You've contributed to them, and you're entitled to those benefits. Instead, you know, the American workforce should be fighting to guarantee that it has access to the same nest egg, the same retirement nest egg we do. It's not a bad thing for workers to get a pension. Because I think sometimes these corporate fat cats forget one thing. Whether you're working on a rail or whether you're working in a grocery store, it's not the people that's sitting in the ivory tower that's making money for the company. It's the people that's out there every day doing the work just like you do. They don't move any trains from the ivory tower. The CEO don't move very many trains. You do. And so they should have some respect for workers, because workers is the one that makes all these fat cats rich, and they should respect us. And you know, one of the things that we need to do to make sure they respect us is to make sure that we're involved. We make sure that we're involved in the election process. Now, I know, you know, I talk about elections in my own local, and sometimes they say, Ken, I'm really tired of hearing about politics. Well, guess what? That's the least favorite part of my job, is dealing with politicians. I mean, think about it. You walk in, they shake your hand, everything you tell them, they nod their head yes, and as you're walking out the door, they're saying, screw that guy, I'm not doing any of that shit. I mean, that's how it works. But fortunately, we have some people in Congress that actually support us. And we've got to support them. You know, the November, I know you've probably already heard it this week about the November midterm elections, but the fact is they're right around the corner. And we're gearing up to support the candidates in Congress and the state capitals that puts workers' interests ahead of those of big business. Because that's all that really matters. You know, we can talk about all the social issues we want, but just take a look at what's went on around this country in the last 4 or 5 years. You got this asshole in Wisconsin, Scott Walker. You know, I'm sure he's in here somewhere. We talked about it last night, one of your legislative people from Wisconsin. We were talking about all the things that this guy's done. And he really, that's really ground zero. He's the guy that really started the attack on workers, taking away their checkoff, taking away their pensions, taking away the state. All the attempt there was to get them out of the union so that they stop coming to the grounds, they stop going out to the elections, they stop fighting corporate America. And you know what? He's been fairly successful at that. We've got a lot of membership loss, all unions, in Wisconsin. But I got news for you. The polls are close. We're going to spend whatever necessary. We're going to have boots on the ground. The general president's heading out there in the next couple of weeks. We're going to do what it takes to kick that asshole out of the governorship in Wisconsin. You know, as I said, the general president's going there. In fact, Jim Hoffa, who, by the way, sends his greetings, he's tied up in other meetings. Both Jim and I are going to be on the road. We're going to be visiting the top-tier states. Top-tier doesn't mean, if we don't visit, doesn't mean your state's not a top-tier state. It means it's not a top-tier in terms of this election. We're going to be in the places where the elections are close, where we can try to get our members out Make sure that they're pounding the pavement for candidates backed by the union, and make sure that we get the vote out. And you know what? The one thing that we can never forget, in 2010, our members stayed home. It was an off-year election, no presidential election. They stayed home, and I don't have to tell you what happened. That's how people like Scott Walker, the governor in Ohio, the governor in Michigan, the people in Indiana, who's all attacking us with right to work and all the other things that they're doing to take away workers' rights, that's how they all got in there. Because we all sat back and said, well, it's an off-year election, so what? Well, I got to tell you, we can't let that happen this time. We can't afford to let corporate America continue their mission to take over this country. Do you know that, and you probably do know this, corporate America has more money, more cash in their pockets today, more cash than at any time in the history of the United States of America. They're not investing. All they're doing here is playing politics. And so, I mean, it makes me sick when I see these Koch brothers. They're going around the country spending millions and millions and millions of dollars. I got news for you. They could give a shit less about anybody in this room. In fact, they wish we were all gone. Because what they want to control the entire country. They want to keep wages down. They don't think anybody should have a pension. And they want to push your health care benefits down. Why is that? The reason for that is because the more they push us down, the more money they make. And you know what I say to them? I say, screw you. We're going to get out. We're going to go out. We're going to work the grounds. We're going to work the elections. We're going to get boots on the ground. And we're going to send them a message. The United States of America is not for sale, because they believe it is. But I got to tell you something. I can stand up here and talk about this all day. I can stand up here and talk about what we're going to do at the International. I can tell you what Jim Hoffa is going to do. I can tell you what Dennis Pierce is going to do. I can tell you what I'm going to do. None of that matters if you're not behind this effort. Because one thing that I have my entire career in this union, you know, I started out as a rank and file. I worked for an oil company. You heard somebody say that. I think John said that. I am incredibly close with our members because I'm one of them. I have a different job, but we're all Teamster members. And so we have got to get out, all of us. This union has no power whatsoever if we don't have the support of our members. You are the union. I'm not the union. Our members are the union. And so, you know, I am fortunate enough to have over the years moved from one position to the other to be in the number two position in the Teamsters. But I say fortunate. It's an honor. And I got there because I had all the support of our members. So this is not a top-down union. We're all the same. You know, I may do a job that you might not be comfortable doing, but God help us all if I had to try to run the train. We'd be in a lot of trouble. I would suggest there'd be a lot of derailments. So we all are Teamsters. And we all have an obligation to get out to the polls and make sure that we do not let these anti-union fat cats control this entire country. You know, we're the largest transportation union in the country. And I got to tell you, we thank you for being a large part of our strength. But our strength is no good if we don't use it. So, you know what? I look at this. You might figure out now that I don't like Wall Street fat cats. If I haven't made that clear, let me make it clear. These assholes destroyed the economy in this country in 2008 and 2009. Not because they had to do this. It's because they weren't happy making millions of dollars. They wanted to make billions of dollars. And so they ran this economy right in the ground with their phony mortgages and all the other things that they did. And what did they get out of that? They drove their banks, they drove their companies in the ground. And once they bought it back up to where they were, they got a bonus. Really? You get a bonus for destroying your company and then bringing it back where it was to start with? And what we got out of that is we suffered from our pension funds taking hits because of their actions. You know, one of the reasons that I feel so strongly about this is because if anyone in this room, if me or any of you, did what those people on Wall Street did, we'd be indicted. Instead of being indicted, they get bonuses. Well, I got to tell you, the bonus that they should have gotten is their fat asses should be in prison today. They destroyed the economy. They caused our members to have to take concessions because they destroyed the economy. They screwed with our pensions. And what happens to them? Nothing. The rich just keep getting richer. So it's time for a change. There's no one else. You know, if you're a non-union worker, you don't have the opportunity to stand up in the workplace and say, this isn't right. The only reason we have that is because we have a union. And so it's our responsibility. It's our responsibility for our kids, for our grandkids. It's our responsibility to take on this fight. And you know what? If we all work together, I am absolutely convinced that we'll win this war. We will beat these fat cats back. We will stop this outrageous corporate America charge to eliminate unions. We will win this battle, but it's only going to be all of us together. So I say, when you get out of this convention and you go home, get out on the street, go talk to your friends, go talk to your neighbors, go talk to anybody that you can get to vote. I'm from West Virginia, so my grandson's 6, so he'll be voting this year. We don't discriminate there. We let them all vote. But I am encouraging you, when you leave here, get out there, get out in your community, make sure your friends, make sure your family, make sure everybody votes. This is a fight that we have to win. You know, we have a lot of non-union people out there. And so there's two ways. There's no question whatsoever. If you've got a union job, your pay and benefits is here. And if you're non-union, they're here. And that's not Teamster rhetoric. That is, if you go to the government and ask them their statistics, they will tell you that that's the way it is. So there's two ways to equalize us. One is to bring us down to their level, which I don't think is the right idea, do you? No. I think the right idea is let's bring those people up to here, and that's what corporate America is afraid of. And that's why we got to get out and bust our ass in this election. So let's get the job done. I know how strong this union is. I know you guys have been around since 1863. Now, not each one of you. But your union is probably, is it the oldest union in the country? So you have a very proud heritage. And we have one with the Teamsters. And together, we can get this done. So let's go win this election. Let's go fight back against corporate America. Let's go out. Let's stop talking about defending ourselves. Let's talk about winning elections so that we are telling politicians, move forward with the things we need to talk about. Move forward with things like stopping one person on the train. Move forward on issues of safety and of protections and of things that we fought for our entire lives. So let's get the job done. Thank you very much.